Hi, this talk is Stability Preserving Time Efficient Mechanisms for School Choice in Two Rounds. And this is joint work with James Liu, Dong Mai, and Vijay Vajirani at UCI. And so let's recap what the classical stable matching problem is. You have n boys and n girls, and you could kind of think of this like a speed dating scenario. And each boy has some preferences over the girls. And each girl has some preferences over the boys as a total order. And the goal is to come up with an assignment of boys and girls. And we say that an assignment has a blocking pair. If there's a boy and girl who prefer each other over the partners that are assigned to in the assignment, right? And so a perfect matching with no blocking pairs is just a stable matching. And the reason why we kind of use this criteria is you could think of it as like, if you have blocking pairs, people are incentivized to break away from the system or the assignment. And so when you have no blocking pairs, you kind of do not have any dissent, right? So people are okay with the matching. So that's kind of the idea. So this was first studied by Gale and Shapley back in the late 60s. And then Nobel Prize winning work, they said, so the first question really is, does every instance actually have a stable matching? And they said, yes. And they provided an algorithm. So they said first, it not only exists, they also gave an algorithm called deferred accept that finds the stable matching. Okay. And so the algorithm itself is very straightforward. Each girl proposes to her favorite boy on her list, and a guy can get multiple proposals. And the guy chooses the best, he tentatively accepts the best proposal he gets. And if a girl gets rejected in any round, she just goes to the next person on her list and proposes, and this keeps happening. And they claim that at the end, this algorithm terminates. Because and it finds a stable matching. Moreover, the benefit of the matching that this produces is this matching also is the girl optimal stable matching. So what that means is there can be many stable matchings, and the stable matching produced by this algorithm is the best for girls. Like whatever best possible partner they can get in any stable matching, they get in this version. Okay, so that's really nice. Another property that was proven about 15, 20 years later was that this algorithm is also strategy proof for girls. And what that means is being honest is the dominant strategy. So you don't gain, so girls don't gain anything by misreporting their preferences. They can only do worse by misreporting their preferences. Okay, so that's good. So we have like this really nice structure. And a reason why classical stable matching is studied a lot is because it's found itself in many applications. So for example, the residents to hospital intern matching was one of its key uses stable matching. Another place is kidney exchange markets. Al Roth has done a lot of work in this. And school choice is another one. For example, the school districts in New York and Boston, they use a version of stable matching to match students to schools. And so we study the problem in the context of school choice. And just to define the problem more concretely, in the setting of school choice, you have a set of schools, H1 to HN, you have a set of students, and each student has some preference list over the schools, you know, a totally ordered preference list. And we allow the inclusion of this element called the empty set. And what that basically means is we're just extending our list to incomplete list. And so any school that comes after the empty set and the preferences, the student does not care about. So if he likes H1 and H3, and then he has the empty set, then he's basically saying, match me to H1 or H3, or don't match me at all. I don't want to be matched to anything that's not H1 or H3. And similarly, schools have preferences, totally ordered preferences over the students. And this could just be thought of something like, you know, maybe it's towards something like proximity to the house or to the school, or, you know, maybe if an elder sibling is in the school, the student gets a higher weightage. I mean, they have some way of computing a total rank, right? And so schools also have a preference list. And every school has a capacity function, just saying that our school can have at most this many students. Okay. And because now we're dealing with, we're moving from one-to-one matching to many-to-one matching, we should also update our definition of a blocking pair, but the idea is still exactly the same, right? Okay, cool. And so some structural properties about this is, so the rule hospital theorem by Roth tells us a very nice, it gives us a nice idea, is that one, if a student is unmatched in a stable matching, it will be unmatched in all stable matchings. It just cannot be matched, right? So that's one part. And if a school is filled below capacity, right? So if a school has like 20 seats and it's only filled with 10 seats, then all stable matchings, it will only fill up 10 seats and the students who fill up will be the same. So that's this is like a we use this property in some of our proofs. And another structural property of stable matching in general is that they form a lattice, and the meet and join is defined where the meet is the students go. So if we have two stable matchings, the meet of two stable matchings is defined as sending the students to the worst to the school they like less among the two matchings, and the join is defined as sending the two schools to the better of the two schools. And both of these are stable matchings, and we basically get that as our meet and join. And the stable matching has a lattice, so this is also a very nice structural property. And we'll see, we'll come back to this in a little bit later on. Okay, so what is the setting we're looking at? So the classical setting is just you have one round, you compute a stable matching, and everybody's happy, and you figure something out, right? We incorporate a little bit more dynamism by having a two-round setting. So what this allows is in round one, you have your normal standard setup. The mechanism just computes the student optimal stable matching. And in round two, parameters change, and that causes the matching to probably no longer be stable, or causes some changes, or there's some new objectives that you want to compute. And the question is, can you extend a matching in some way, or update a matching in some way? So we get a new matching in round two. And so that's a problem we're going to be looking at. And we can divide our results into three parts, type A, type B, type C. Type A results are the form where in round one, the matching that's computed is fixed. So if a student is matched to a school in round one, that student must be matched to the same school in round two. So we can't unmatch somebody or match them somewhere else. And in that sense, can we extend our matching in any way? So that's a question we ask in round two under certain scenarios, and it'll make more sense a little bit later on. Type B is also just saying we're allowed to reassign some students, but we want to minimize the number of students we do this to. And type C is just a bunch of empty hardness results. Okay, so let's look at setting A1 first. So this is just the classical problem. In round one, we have a stable matching. And we ask, okay, so let SM be the students who were matched in round one. And the question we ask is, okay, what about the students who were not matched? Is there any way of extending our stable matching in a way that we can also add these guys to the matching? So what we claim is there exists a mechanism that can extend our original matching and add the maximum number of students from L as it can, so that we can find a matching that maximizes the number of students who can be matched without unmatching anybody from the original matching. Okay, and how do we go about doing this? Well, for each school, I guess the first question is we ask is, what if we gave a school infinite capacity, right? And we send everybody who was unmatched to this school. When is a blocking pair, is a blocking pair induced, or is this okay? And if you think about it, a blocking pair is induced if there's some student who's in SM who prefers that school to the school he's matched to, right? Because then if any of the people we're adding comes after him in the preferences, they form a blocking pair, right? Okay. So more concretely, a barrier for a school is the best student in SM who prefers that school to the school he's currently matched to. Okay. And so we can define a barrier for every school. And what we then say is for all the students in L, if for any school you come left of a barrier, we'll let you, we create new preferences and we add the school to your preference list. And at the end, we send for each student in L, we just send them to the, it's possible that they don't come to the left of any barrier, that's okay. But what we say is in these updated preferences, if a school was added, we just send you to the best possible school and we return this new matching M prime. Okay, and so the first question is, are any blocking pairs induced? By construction of our barriers, or definition rather, no blocking pairs can be induced because they're to the left of the barrier. Anything to the right of the barrier will induce a blocking pair. What about the students who didn't get matched in round two? Well, that means that they must have been to the right of the barrier for every school, and matching them to any school would induce a blocking pair between the barrier of that school and the school itself. And so the people who were not matched could not be matched in any extension. And the last question is it incentive compatible? And this is where it gets, you know, our first bad result in some sense, or negative result, is that it's not. And how do we see this? Well, let's look at the example here. We have two students in two schools, S1 and S2. S1 likes H1 over H2, and S2 also likes H1 over H2. And H1 and H2, they have opposite preferences. H1 likes S1 and S2. H2 likes S2 and S1. In round one, both schools have capacity one in round one. So if there was honest reporting, the matching would have been S1, H1, S2, H2 in round one. And in round two, there'll be no changes made because there'll be no updates made because the matching is complete. But if suppose S2 misreports a preference list as H1 and the empty set, well, then M is equal to S1, H1, and M prime is also, S2 gets matched to H1 in round two, because he just says I will not be matched to H2. And so S2 does bad because S2 likes H1 more than H2, it does better by cheating, right? Okay, so this basically tells us that, okay, we cannot design incentive compatible mechanisms for this kind of a setting, which is kind of a bad thing. Okay, so for setting A2 is very similar to setting A1. The only thing is now we also allow the inclusion of new participants in round two. So a set of new students arrive in round two. And a new problem here is now that when we have new participants arriving, this could result in, you know, the matching becoming unstable immediately, right? And so what we ask, at least in min and max L, is, okay, so new students arrive, find the minimum number of new students you need to update this matching, and subject to that, maximize the number of students from L who you match, okay? And what we show is we provide three polynomial time mechanisms for min and max L, max and max L, and max N union L. And they're all defined the same way. We'll discuss, for the purpose of this talk, we'll just discuss about min and max L. The others are very similar. And again, so the idea follows from barriers again, but we can't just apply our barriers from before. So let's think about this. So any student who forms a blocking pair with the matching in N must be matched, right? Because if he's not matched, he'll always form a blocking pair. That's not changing anything, okay? So let S and L be the students who are not matched, right? For the students from N who do not form blocking pairs. And let's consider this. So if we just consider the barriers defined by students in SM, that's not enough because there could be students. And so we don't want to match students in S and L because we're trying to minimize the number of students from N who are matched. We have to match the students in N. So S and L, we don't want to match them. So even they form barriers. And so we want to include them too. And so we define our barrier to be the stricter of the barrier defined by students in SM and students in SNL. Okay, once we do this, we follow the same idea from before. We update our preference list for all the students in L and N minus SNL to include the schools where they lie left of the barrier. And then we just match them to the favorite schools, right? And why does minimize and maximize L? Well, first, the only people who are being matched are the people who have to be matched. We're not matching anybody extra. And subject to that, anybody who's unmatched must be to the right of the barrier, so they cannot be matched. And so we're maximizing L2. And so we do min and max L, and the other ones could be for max and max L or max and union L, they could be computed similarly. Okay, so we also show, so we've shown this, but a couple of other variants of the same problem are actually turned to be NP-hard. So for example, max L min N or max N min L, where you're trying to maximize L and subject to that minimize N, turn out to be NP-hard. And the reduction actually follows from set cover, where the idea kind of is that the minimum N you pick, you kind of design a gadget so that they represent the sets you'd pick in optimal set cover. So that's kind of how the reduction works. Another problem we kind of show that generalizes both of these is, suppose we ask, like, pick K students from N, so that, like, pick the a subset of K students so that it maximizes the number of students who can match from L. And I think this problem kind of generalizes the previous two problems and then shows kind of the hardness of this problem. Yeah, and the reduction is very similar from set cover. So these are kind of some hardness results we had for A2. If you wanna see the proofs, you can look at them in the paper. They're very simple, straightforward reductions. Okay, we're setting B1. So now we move on to settings of type B. And now the question is, now we're no longer restricted by the fact that we have to, we cannot unmatch somebody. We can now move some people around. So people can be matched at different schools in two different rounds. And so in this setting, we have the same in round one, a stable matching is computed, and in round two, a set of new schools arrive, right? And the question is, okay, so now these new schools arrive, what happens is, well, so some students may want to leave the new schools because they like the new schools more than the current schools, right? And when if they leave, then the new vacancy is left in the schools they were part of, so somebody else wants to come there, and you have a bunch of swaps that keep happening. And the question is, okay, so Can we come up with a mechanism that finds a stable matching under the inclusion of these new schools and minimizes the number of people who have to move schools from their original matching? And we answer yes, we provide a mechanism for exactly that. And I guess the first question is there, like, the naive approach would be to, like, just run Gale Shapley on the new updated instance with the new schools. But we kind of show in this example that it causes more reallocations, and I won't go into this because probably don't have enough time. But the idea of the slide was just to tell you that, okay, there exists instances where, you know, running guild shipping will not give me the best, will require more reallocations. And so let's first understand the structure of minimum stable reallocations. I'll call them MSRs. Well, each student weekly improves in any minimum stable reallocation. Okay, this is kind of a trivial statement, mainly because if you're adding new schools and there's nobody competing for your seat in any sense, right? So like you cannot lose your seat, you can only do better. So that's kind of the intuition. And the second one I think is more fundamental and very, very interesting, which is that all minimum stable reallocations move the same set of students. Okay, so what is that? What does moving a student mean? That means that suppose you were matched to a school in round one, you're moved if in round two you're matched to a different school, right? So the claim is that if you're moved in one minimum stable reallocation, you have to be moved in all minimum stable reallocations. And let's prove this statement actually, because I think it's interesting. So let's imagine you're a student, and for contradiction, let's just assume like there are two minimum stable reallocations. In one of them you're moved, and in the other you're not moved. Okay, so there are four possible cases, which I've listed here: S1, S2, S3, S4. If we look at the matching, so S1 is just saying that you're the same in M prime but different in M double prime. S2 is the inverse. S3 is saying you're different in both M prime and M double prime, and S4 is saying you're the same in both M and M prime. Okay, you're matched the same school in both rounds. Okay, and to show a contradiction, let's look at the matching ML defined to be the meat of these two matchings. So ML is equal to M prime and M double prime. So the meat of two matchings is just sending each student in both these matchings. So suppose a student is matched to school H1 and school in M prime and school H2 and M double prime, and it likes H1 more than H2, then an ML will send SI to H2, right? So we'll send him the worst of the two schools he's matched to in these two matchings. Well, if we do that, and since stable, the meat is defined, these are stable, so since M prime and M double prime are both stable matchings, the meat is also a stable matching because this is the same operation of the lattice. So we already know this. So we know that ML is a stable matching, but ML, if you look at the number of reallocations made in ML, S1, ML will only require the cardinality of the of S3, that many reallocations, because S1, S2, and S4 will all go back to M. Suppose S1, from lemma one, we know that everybody weekly improves. So the set S1 will send all its students back to M. The set S4 trivially will send all of them back to M. And similarly, S2 will send them all back to M because that's the worst of the two schools. So S3 is the only place where reallocations happen. So the cardinality is, so the number of reallocations is just the set, the cardinality of the sets of S3. But if I look at M prime or M double prime, the cardinality is going to be S1 and S3 or S2 and S3, right? And since S1 or S2 is non-empty by assumption, that means that ML requires fewer reallocations than M prime or M double prime. But by assumption, we already said that, but that's a contradiction because M prime and M double prime are minimum stable reallocations. So we've come up with a MSR that requires fewer reallocations, and that's not good, right? So that's how we prove this. And so using this, we can actually get a nice result, which is the set of minimum stable reallocations form a sublattice of the stable matching lattice. And to kind of see this, you can divide the students into students who get moved, right? We already shown that that set is fixed from the previous lemma, and the set of students who are fixed. Well, if you're fixed, you're gonna be fixed throughout like all minimum stable reallocations. So we can kind of just forget about you and look at the smaller stable matching instance that's defined over the set of students who are moved. And so once we do this, we can now define like a much tinier stable matching instance, and then since we know that all stable matching instances have like a lattice structure, we have this lattice structure for this smaller instance, and then we can just join the students who are fixed, like we can concatenate them to this matching, and we get like a stable matching in our new setting, right? And it still has the lattice properties of the smaller stable matching instance, and so we have like the sublattice of the stable matching lattice, and that represents all the minimum stable reallocations. So this is like another kind of nice structural property that we see, and the real question now is I guess the theorem we were proving is that we can find the top and the bottom of this lattice, right? And So what is the mechanism for finding like for finding the bottom in this case? We have a mechanism that finds the school optimal minimum stable reallocation, and how it works is simple. While a school has a vacant seat and there exists a student who wants to go there or who prefers that school to the school it's currently matched to, we assign them and we match the student to that school and we keep going, right? And we show that this algorithm terminates and returns the school optimal minimum stable reallocation. And to see a proof for this, it's just induction. It's where it's not too bad. So then the question is, okay, we can find the school optimal stable reallocation. What about like a student optimal minimum stable reallocation? How do we find this? And the idea is you could run the school optimal minimum reallocation and find like the fixed set, the moving set, and you can construct that smallest stable matching instance. And you can look at a student optimal matching in that smaller instance and get like student optimal minimum stable reallocations. The problem again though is this is still not incentive compatible, and that's a big problem. For setting V2, we kind of look at problems. We look at the same problem, but instead of having new schools come around too, we look at new students and we design again the polynomial mechanism for finding a minimum stable reallocation with in the setting. But so the proof structure for this again is very similar to the proof structure before, mainly because it's in some sense it's solving the same problem. So you can reduce the many to one case of stable matching to a one to one case of stable matching. And so if you do that and you think about setting V1, you can think of it as like a bipartite graph, where in round two a set of new edges come to the left side of the bipartition, and now you want to update your matching to minimize some kind of changes. Well, setting V2 is asking the same problem, but now you have like nodes coming from the right side of your bipartition, right? So essentially a lot of the proof structure is very symmetric. And so we can prove a lot of the same results we prove for setting V1 and setting V2. And we do that. So that those are our results for polynomial time mechanisms. Finally, we also show, and I was running out of time, so I decided not to present these two. We had two more problems that are NP-hard. And you can look at them in the paper. Again, even those reductions come from set cover, but they're nice and I think they're interesting problems in their own right. And so I'll start with some open problems. One problem is, can we design incentive compatible mechanisms? So the problem right now is for some of the settings we showed, there's no way of designing incentive compatible mechanisms from the way they're defined, but maybe being more restrictive, for example, not allowing incomplete lists and saying you can only have complete lists or some more rigid structure, will that allow the construction of incentive compatible mechanisms? So I think this is the biggest open problem. And the second one I think is also interesting in its own right is approximation algorithms for NP-hard problems. I think a lot of the approximation problems reduces like harder variant of set cover. And I think the problem itself, independent of school choice, is interesting in its own right. And I think just designing approximation algorithms for that problem will be really, really, is a nice, clean, open problem. That's all I had, and thank you guys.